In this video, we are going to take a look at the mate and flush assembly constraints in Autodesk Inventor. I have a blank assembly here. I'm going to place a couple of components here. And typically when I place the first component, I want to go ahead and ground it to the origin. So I'll go ahead and right click and place grounded at origin. And I'm just going to go ahead and place another copy of this shape here as well. And then press escape. It's important to ground the first component because when you are constraining parts together, you want one component to be stuck in space. Then that way you can constrain everything else to the grounded component. Here on the Assemble tab, in the Relationships panel, is the Constrain tool. I'll begin by selecting Constrain. You can see that this dialog box begins on the Assembly tab, and the default constraint is the mate, which is what we're going to talk about right now. Over here on the right are my two selections. Notice that they're color-coded. That allows me to go back and see which is which later. And what I want to do then for a mate is I want to put two faces together. So if I want to push these two rectangles up against each other, I'm going to use the mate. So I'll go ahead and select one of the faces here, and then I can select the face on the other part as well. And I can go ahead and click apply to accept that. Now I can go ahead and continue constraining, but I'm going to cancel so I can go out and look and see exactly what I did there. You can see that those two are now pressed up against each other. If I click and drag, it might look like I just dragged this part out to the right, but if I look straight at it, I can see what I actually did was drag it up because they are constrained to each other. So speaking of constraints, you can go to the View tab, then select degrees of freedom to see a little widget that indicates which directions it's still available to move. So by default, a part has 6 degrees of freedom. It can go back and forth in the X, Y, and Z axes, and it can rotate around each of those axes as well. So you can see that we've taken away a couple of the rotations and the ability to move along this axis. I'm going to place another constraint to help get this locked down. So I'll choose my Constrain tool again. And then this time what I want to do is I want the top of this rectangle and the top of this rectangle to coincide with each other. As we look at our solution options in here, we have a mate and we have a flush. In either case, if I select two planes, the two planes will press up against each other. The mate will put the parts on opposite sides of those planes, and the flush will put them on the same side. So flush is actually what I'm going for in this one. I'll choose that option. Select the two planes, and as you can see, it brings them lined up. If I switch it to mate, you can see what happens is the two planes line up, but the parts are on opposite sides of the plane. Flush, they're going to be on the same side. I'll go ahead and click apply, then cancel. And now you can see I'm only able to just simply move it back and forth. So now for my last constraint, I will go ahead and create another flush between two of the side surfaces here, and then apply. Notice the degrees of freedom symbol is gone because they are fully constrained now. You can edit constraints by finding them in the model browser. So notice that under each part, it's going to show me each constraint that was used on that part. And it's also going to show me which plane it applies to. So if I want to edit one, let's say that I didn't want these two parts right up against each other. I want to have maybe 5 millimeters of space between them. I'm going to right click on this mate and edit. It just takes me right back into the original dialog box. Here in the offset section, I can put in a value and then click OK. And now you can see they're fully constrained, but instead of being pressed right up against each other, they have an offset value. You can also suppress constraints if you want to temporarily turn them off. I'm going to right click on that same constraint and choose suppress. I now have the ability to move the part in and out. So I'm going to try something else now. I'm going to move this a certain distance and then I'm going to actually delete that constraint. I can unsuppress it. When I do, it's going to go back to where it was. But let's say that I deleted this constraint. And maybe I have some other geometry and I'm trying to get this rectangular shape close to a certain distance away based on some other geometry. And when I choose my Constrain tool, as soon as I do the mate, they're going to press up against each other and I'm going to lose where I had that. So I'm going to undo. What I'm going to do this time then is when I constrain, I'm going to turn this option right here on, predict offset and orientation. And what that's going to do is instead of pushing these two parts together, it's going to create a constraint and it's going to bring that value in to my dialog box and automatically give me that offset value. So maybe I was kind of eyeballing it and I can see what this value is, and maybe I decide, okay, I want a 70 millimeter offset that suits my needs. Another thing that I want to point out in this dialog box is the preview button. So this is turned on by default. That's what's allowing me to see how things are going to look as they are constraining together. I'm going to bring another copy of this part in here. And in each of the examples I just gave you, I constrained faces. We can also constrain points and edges as well. So let's look at a point example. I'll choose my constrain tool. I need to make sure that the predict offset is turned off. That will typically stay on if you use it. Then I'm going to come in here and pick a point. I'm going to hover here until my select other tool pops up. Then I can either click the drop down or use the scroll wheel to choose the vertex. And then I'll do the same thing on this other part here. When the select other pops up, I'll choose the vertex. I'll go ahead and apply that together and cancel. And now you can see that this time I just put the two points together. So I have kind of a swivel action between these two. Let's look at another example. This time I'll do a couple of edges. So I'll create a constraint between this edge and this edge. I can go ahead and apply that and cancel it. And now you can see that they are locked in on that edge. But again, I need some additional constraints to fully constrain it. Next, we'll take a look at how we can use the mate constraint to constrain the axes of cylindrical shapes. First, I'm going to take this round shape and constrain it into this part. Notice that I've got a little extrusion sticking out on one side. That's to help us see what the orientation options are. So I'll go ahead and use my constrain tool. When I hover over a cylindrical shape, it's going to give me its axis. So I'll select that one, then I'll select this other one. Now, I've lined the two axes up. I have some options here. We have aligned, opposed, and undirected. So right now it's set to aligned. If I set it to opposed, you can see what happened is it actually flipped the part the other direction. So in either case, the axes are lined up, but this just lets me help lock in the orientation. I can also do undirected. For this one, it's not going to do the orientation at all. This allows me a little more flexibility. If I want to come back and flip the part later, I can do so. I'll go ahead and apply and cancel. And now you can see that this part can spin and it can also move in and out. So to remove the spinning, I'm going to create a mate constraint between the cylinder at the bottom and the hole. So I'll choose that axis and that axis there. Now in this one, it's a little more important which way it's directed. I don't want it going this way. I want it going down into the part. So I'll go ahead and apply that and cancel. So now we can see that this part is fully constrained. I'm going to constrain the cap similarly by choosing the cylinder there and the cylinder there. This one's a symmetrical part, so it really doesn't matter which of these options I use. So I'll apply and cancel that. Now you can see that it's free to move in and out. I'm going to make a flush constraint between these front two surfaces. So I'll choose flush and apply that. You can see it's still able to spin though. I could choose some sort of angular constraint, but really what I want to do is line up the axis of the holes here. So I'm going to do just that. I will constrain the axis of this one with the axis of the one inside there. And now this one is fully constrained. Let's see what happens if you try to overconstrain something. Let's say that I wanted to constrain and put these faces together as a mate. When I hit apply, I'm going to get an error because that really conflicts with the axis relationship that I created earlier. So I can either accept and I'll basically have an error, or I can edit to keep modifying it, or I can go ahead and just cancel for now. So Autodesk Inventor will not allow you to overconstrain your assemblies, just like it won't allow you to overconstrain sketches. That concludes this look at mate and flush constraints in Autodesk Inventor.